Frank Sinatra, the chairman of the board, old Blue Eyes himself, has been dazzling audiences for decades. Unfortunately, Mr. Sinatra is no longer with us. But I came across a delightful young man who took it upon himself to keep Mr. Sinatra's music and his legacy alive. It brings me great pleasure to bring to you Mr. Guy Matone.
She gets hungry for dinner at 8. She loves the theater, doesn't come late. She'd never bother with anyone she'd hate. That's why the lady is a tramp. Doesn't like dice games with barons or earls. She won't go to Harlem in ermine and pearls. She won't dish the dirt with the rest of those girls. That's why the lady is a tramp. Likes that free, fresh wind in her hair, life without a care. She's broke, but it's oak, hates California. It's cold and it's damp. That's why the lady is a champ. Gets too hungry to wait for dinner at 8. She loves the theater, but she never runs in there late. She'd never bother with anyone she'd hate. That is why the lady is a tramp. She'll have no crap games with sharpies and frauds. She won't go to Harlem in shiny Lincolns or Fords. And she will not dish that dirt with the rest of those broads. That's why this chick is a champ. Fine, wild, knocked down, cool, groovy wind in her hair. Life without a care. She's broke, but it's oak. She hates California. It's so crowded and damp. And that's why the lady. That's why the lady is a champ.
Welcome to the Timmy Willis Show. Get on your cell phones and start spreading the news because we got a very special guest with us today, Mr. Guy Matone. How you doing?
Hi, Tim. Nice to be here.
All right. Good seeing you. Hey, let me ask you, where were you born at, Guy?
I was born in Pittsburgh. I lived till I was 4 years old down in Homewood, Brushton, on
a
little street called Conema Street, right behind Frankstown Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
And then we moved out to Penn Hills, and I've been out there ever since.
Okay. So. Well, what was it like for you, like, growing up in Penn Hills?
It was nice. You know, back then, kids all played outside together. I mean, we played street football, we rode bikes, played hide-and-seek, and everything. We were always outside playing, you know.
Okay.
Now, you look around the neighborhood nowadays, you don't see too many kids out there playing anymore.
No,
you know,
they're
all in on computers and playing games and stuff, yeah. We were a lot more active whenever
we
were kids.
Yeah, you know, and I have that same story to tell. But, you know, what was about the art of singing that caught your interest?
I don't know, because I can't even remember whenever I started loving it. I just always, it seems like I always did it. Like, from the day I was born, you know, as soon as I was old enough to talk, I was starting to sing.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the first things I ever heard was Frank Sinatra, because that's what my parents liked.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we had one of those little phonographs with the 45, 33 speed on it, and I got to use some of their old scratched up albums, and that's what they had, so that's what I listened to, and I loved it. I loved it back then just as much as I do now, even whenever I was a little kid. So even though I went through the rock and roll era and everything, and loved all that music as well, I never lost my love for the Frank Sinatra music. I mean, I'd pop out a Rolling Stones tape and put in a Sinatra tape right afterwards.
Right, yeah,
you know,
yeah. So. That's some what you call versatility.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Well, what about school? Did you do any singing in school?
No, just I was in the like seventh grade chorus or something like that, you know.
Okay. Yeah.
And always had a deeper voice. Mm-hmm. I get to do the deep parts, you know.
Right.
But I never pursued it much there. In fact, it was always just pretty much singing in the car, singing in the shower most of my life, mm-hmm. you know. And then some friends and I decided to go down to a karaoke bar down in Penn Hills.
Mm-hmm.
And there was people getting up and singing, and some of them were good, and some of them were terrible. And somebody got up and sang a Frank Sinatra song, and they slaughtered it. And I just said, you know what, I finally got the nerve up, and I got up and grabbed the microphone, and the whole place went nuts.
Yeah.
And they just said, what are you doing here? You should be out in Las Vegas or something, you know. Why are you doing this? What do you do for a living and everything? And I was detailing cars at the time. And then I got out of detailing cars and started waiting tables, and went to all the different karaoke bars and started to get a little bit known around Penn Hills area, Monroeville, and stuff like that. And there was a DJ, the first bar that I went to sing, I started learning a little bit how to use his music and use his equipment, and whenever he would want to go take a little break or something like that, I'd throw the songs in for the people to get up and sing.
Mm-hmm.
And then my cousin opened up a bar down on Road I Road. It was called Mr. Ribs. It's not there anymore.
Okay.
And he let me use all his equipment to do the karaoke DJ thing down there.
Mm-hmm.
So when nobody was singing, I would sing. You know, early in the night before people started coming or whatever, I would just keep singing and singing.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started making a collection of CDs to where I got enough where I can do a show on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And some people from the Wooden Nickel out Monroeville stopped down to see me, and they said, hey, we got a guy out here that's been bugging us to come out, and he does Dean Martin. What would you think about getting together with him and doing a Frank and Dean show? And I said, sure, that sounds good. I'd try it, you know. So I met the guy, and when I met him, I had realized that I knew him from years before, just from around town and stuff like that. And we started singing out the Wooden Nickel every Wednesday night, and that went on for about 3.5 years. We're still out there, in fact. We're out there the last Wednesday of every month.
Mm-hmm.
And we started out on, they built a new patio on the back, and we started singing out there.
Okay.
And what was happening was a lot of people, after they were done eating dinner, they'd stick around for a little bit and it would clear out. So they decided to move us into the bar area. And we just packed them in there. Every Wednesday we were out there, you know, it was jam-packed and it went well.
Okay.
It sort of sprang from there.
Yeah. Now the karaoke thing that you just spoke about, how long ago was that when that all started, when you first started?
I'd say probably almost 6 years now, maybe.
It was 6 years
somewhere
ago?
Somewhere around that, yeah, because at the time I was doing that and still waiting tables also.
Yeah.
That was just something I was doing on the side.
So basically, you saying up until 6 years ago, you really wasn't doing any professional singing?
No.
Really? So this is really relatively new for you?
Pretty new. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's
probably
interesting.
Once it started, it took off and went solid. So I've been doing it probably straight for about 4.5 to 5 years.
Have you ever thought that, you know, I should have been doing this decades ago?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Better late than never, though, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you got another song prepared for us?
Sure do.
What, you know which one is?
I think this one coming up is Nice and Easy.
Nice and Easy.
Yeah.
We're looking forward to it. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Guy Matone doing Nice and Easy.
Let's take it nice and easy. It's gonna be so easy for us to fall in love. Hey baby, what's your hurry? Relax and don't you worry. We're gonna fall in love. We're on the road to romance, that's safe to say, but let's make all the stops along the way. The problem now, of course, is to simply hold your horses. To rush would be a crime, 'cause nice and easy does it every time. We're on the road to romance, that's safe to say, but let's make all the stops along the way. The problem now, of course, is to simply hold your horses. To rush would be a crime, 'cause nice and easy does it. Nice and easy does it. Nice and easy does it every time. Like the man says one more time. Nice and easy does it. Nice and easy does it. Nice and easy does it. Every time. Boom, 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 boom.
Sitting here talking to Mr. Guy Matone. He's put together a very, very fabulous tribute to Mr. Frank Sinatra. You were speaking earlier about the Frank and Dean show out at the Wooden Nickel. I was just curious about how does that work? Do you come out and sing, and then he comes out and sing?
Yeah, we take turns.
You come out and do you do anything together?
We do a couple songs together every once in a while. It usually messes me up.
Really?
So I like to do them alone. But every once in a while we'll get together and do a song. We'll do New York, New York together. Or, You Make Me Feel So Young is one we do together every mm-hmm. once in a while. And I also sing Neil Diamond a little bit. So some people like the Neil Diamond better than the Frank Sinatra. Actually, it depends what they're a fan of, I guess, the most. But I do mostly Frank Sinatra and a little bit of Neil Diamond. And I'll do a set, and then he'll do a set, and then I'll come back out. And he'll do a couple other things too, Perry Como and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But we stick mostly to Frank and Dean in our show. I'd say that's the majority of the show.
So you do some Neil Diamond as well?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What about any other singers? I was
going
to ask you.
Well, I was going to tell you, yeah, I'll mess around with a little Barry White or something every
White.
Once in a while, but you ain't going to get me to sing it on the show today.
Barry,
yeah.
Well, let me ask you this, Guy. When you were growing up, I know you mentioned about Frank Sinatra. You know, your parents had the Frank Sinatra albums around the house. Or is there any other singers or groups that caught your attention or kind of influenced you?
Yeah, I always loved the Beatles. After getting some of my parents' albums, I had an older brother, and I got all of his albums, too. Some of them he gave to me, and some of them, when he wasn't looking, I would sneak and play them, you know. So I grew up on the Beatles and the Stones and the Temptations and the Supremes and all that stuff. I mean, I liked it all, you know.
Yeah.
Never big on country, but I'm actually starting to like it a little more now than I did most of my life. You know, mm-hmm. hearing some of the artists that are out there now, there's some good stuff.
Yeah.
But rock and roll and Frank Sinatra was in Motown, you know, all that stuff.
Right, right.
Now, all the oldies. Mm-hmm. Like.
Now, all that music that you just mentioned, that was real music, as far as I'm concerned.
Absolutely.
I mean, they had the lyrical content, you know.
Harmony.
They had the hook, you know, like the Beatles. I want to hold your hand. That was the hook.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You went around singing that, you know.
Yeah.
But the three-part harmonies, you know, when you had the Temptations and singing groups like that with the harmonies and all that. But what do you think about the music today? I mean, because all that stuff seems like it just was thrown out the window.
Well, I'll tell you, every once in a while I'll hear a song and I'll say, that's not bad. I like that. I could listen to that. But I don't go out and buy CDs or the albums or anything like that of any of the groups that I hear now. You know, like you'll hear one song by a group or something like that sounds good. To tell you the truth, I don't even listen to the radio anymore. As much as I'm into music, I either play tapes that I already have with the music that I like on them, mm-hmm. or I listen to talk radio. Mm-hmm. Because it's just, when I put on FM, I end up just sitting there switching stations, because it's just hard finding a good song that I like anymore, you know, with the new music.
Right.
So if I do, I'll listen to an oldie station or something like that, you know. But
well, you ever wonder? I wonder where did we make the wrong turn?
I don't know.
Because all those years, I mean, you go back to like the Mills Brothers.
Yeah.
You can go back to the 40s and 50s, man. All that was great music, and then somewhere down the line, it got crazy.
It does seem like some of the artists are trying to bring it back now. Like they might do a whole album of that type of music, like Tony Bennett did, you know, and even some of the younger performers now, I'm noticing, watching American Idol and stuff like that, different mm-hmm. shows, you'll see them bringing back some of the old songs, and I think they enjoy it too, even though they might do newer versions or something like that, they still like it, and they have to admire that type of music because there was such great quality to it, you know.
Yeah.
How could you not like it? You know?
Right. I give you an example. Charlie Chaplin, that song Smile that he wrote, man, that's a beautiful song.
Yep.
You know, smile when your heart is aching.
Yep.
Smile even though it's breaking. You know, I just listened to that song, man, and it just, it does something to you. And that's what the songs used to do. You
right.
used to could feel something. You could
right.
relate to something. It was a story that we could all relate to. And that's just, hopefully, like you said, some people are trying to bring that back in.
Yep.
So I'm hoping that they reel it back in and we get back to the
I don't see much
again.
Much other of a direction for it to go.
I mean,
it seemed like it went down, and now it's maybe it'll start going back up again. People will start coming back to it.
Right.
You get some of the younger people that are in school now that are in orchestras, you know, they play violin or whatever and stuff like that, and they still play the good, beautiful music, you know. So you know they have an ear for it, you know. And it's amazing to me when I'm out in different places singing, the young people that I'll see standing over there, and they're singing along with me. They know the words to the mm-hmm. old Frank Sinatra songs and the Neil Diamond songs,
yeah.
you know. So they do know it, and whether they just listen to it whenever their parents listen to it and that's how they know the songs, or whether they like it themselves, but mm-hmm. I mean, they'll come up to me and say, great job, and love that, you know, love that music and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of it has to do with some of them, at least, if they have a band background, you know, mm-hmm. and they like that type of music, because with the symphony behind you playing like Frank Sinatra had, you know, the big bands that he had playing behind him. You just can't beat that sound.
You're right, you're right. Now, what about Vegas? Have you ever thought about, have you ever been there or thought about, you know,
I've
taking your show to Vegas?
Only been there once, and I always say when California falls off the map and they have an ocean in Vegas, then I'll go to Vegas because I'm a beach kind of person. Other than that, it's all just a bunch of big buildings and bright lights to me, and you know, I'd rather stick around the Pittsburgh area, especially now that we're getting some casinos opening up around here. You know, we're getting one in Pittsburgh pretty soon, and hopefully I'll be able to get enough work around here that I may not ever have to make that move out there. You know, if I do, I would say I would go out and do it for a period of time and then come back to Pittsburgh.
Right.
I just don't think it's my lifestyle.
Atlantic City? Ever consider that?
Atlantic City.
Yeah.
That wouldn't be bad.
Because one reason why I'm saying that, because what you do it really well.
Yes.
I mean, you do it so well that if someone would need someone to do something like that in a part for a movie, man, you'd be perfect. But have you made yourself available? Do they know about you in those areas?
Probably not.
Yeah.
Probably not.
That might be something you might want to look into.
Right.
You know what I mean? Let these people know, hey, here I am. This is what I do. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we're going to start working on a website for me, and once that happens, I expect I'll be getting some calls from some faraway places, different areas.
Well, speaking of calls, man, how can people get in touch with you? I know some people out there saying, man, I got to get in touch with this cat, man. How can they do that?
Well, I just have my home phone number that they're welcome to call me on.
Okay.
412-793-6304.
Okay.
And, you know, if I'm not there, I have an answering machine. They can leave a message, and I'll get back to them.
Cool. And, well, what about some more music? You got some more music prepared for us?
Sure, I got another one for you. One of my favorites coming up.
Yeah, I think I know which one this is. Fly Me to the Moon.
Yeah.
One of my favorites. Ladies and gentlemen, get ready to fly to the moon with Mr. Guy Matone.
Fly me to the moon, let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand. In other words, baby, kiss me. Song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, with song and let me sing forevermore. You are all I long for, all I worship and adore. In other words,
for those of you just joining us, you are missing it again. We're here with Mr. Guy Matone. Hey, let me ask you a question. Okay. You've been packing the house at a place downtown. You want to tell us about it? You know what I'm talking about?
Oliver Twist.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, I'm not down there anymore.
Oh, you're not?
No. But for about 3.5 years, I was down there every Thursday.
Wow. That's a pretty good stretch.
Yep. Yeah, they kept me down there for quite some time, and we did pack them in down there, especially if there was anything going on downtown. And then they got into more into jazz and stuff like that down there.
Mm-hmm.
So right now I'm doing a lot of private stuff, parties, weddings, mm-hmm. corporate events, stuff like that. And I'm also down at the Mountain Air Racetrack and Casino. I just started down there.
Okay.
So they're going to have me sometimes up on the what they call the tower down there. It's the stage above the bar. I'll be up there sometimes, and then sometimes I'll be back in the mahogany room, which is a real nice bar back there that they have, mm-hmm. a nice high-class bar back there.
Yeah.
Sort of a piano bar.
Okay.
And usually I'm with somebody else. Like last time I was down there, there was an Elvis with me. And then next time I think I'm going to be with a Dean Martin and a Sammy Davis guy down there.
Okay.
And then I got a guy that who does all Neil Diamond. I'll be singing with him some night down there too.
Okay,
well,
cool.
So I got a few dates down there booked up.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask you this: like, how does that make you feel when you're doing your thing, man? You can see the reaction on people's faces, man, and they're really enjoying it, you know, and they're kind of like reflecting. Like, one of the songs you sing, it might be the song that they fell in love with their wife with,
right,
50 years ago and stuff like that. How does that make you feel?
Right, that makes me feel good. You know,
yeah.
You know, when you hit a spot like that, you know, and like down at the casino, it's neat because people are walking by and they're walking around. They don't really know where the music's coming from, and then they look up and see me, and they're up pointing at me, you know, and then uh-huh. they'll stand there and listen for a while, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, you get like when I do weddings, almost everybody has a favorite Frank Sinatra song where the bride and groom come in, they'll have me sing that song, you know, like mm-hmm. Just the Way You Look Tonight is a big one for weddings, mm-hmm. you know. So, yeah, it's really nice whenever you hit a certain nerve with certain people and they say, well, that was me and my husband's, you know, favorite song.
Yeah.
You know?
Now, I know people have come up to you with their stories. And, you know, as far as like what we were just talking about, you know, this was our favorite song or this was our wedding song or something like that. Do you have any most memorable experience like that that stands out that someone has said something to you, how you have touched them?
Not that I can remember. It happens quite often. And it's mm-hmm. usually just a brief moment that we speak, you know, so... Mm-hmm. I don't remember any in particular, but
okay.
It's funny, I get a lot of people that come up to me and will tell me about when they saw Frank Sinatra or they were out in Las Vegas and they got invited over to his table and different stories like that.
Okay.
People will tell me,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
kind of interesting,
yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Well, now, looking back on, since you started this whole ride here, looking back on it all, do you have any most memorable moments to date right now? Anything that stands out in your mind as something that's like really memorable that happened, an experience or something?
Not really.
No?
No. Sorry about that, but nothing that sticks out in my mind. No, not really.
What about any radio time?
I did a commercial for the Wooden Nickel. We took a Frank Sinatra song and changed it around a little bit. And
is that right?
Threw a few different words in there, but
yeah.
It was kind of neat.
What
yeah.
was that like, that whole experience?
That was pretty cool.
Yeah.
The girl that used to do the Shop and Save commercials had me down, and it was a...
Where is she? I haven't seen her in quite a while.
I haven't seen her in a while either. Kathy, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
I forget what her last name is. But... she had me down in a studio down in Swissville,
mm-hmm.
and we did the commercial down there. It was fun. You know, it was kind of neat, you know.
Yeah. Now, what about your own recordings? Have you ever thought about, or do you have a CD out?
I don't. I have a CD where I sing the Sinatra and Neil Diamond songs on it, basically for promotional purposes.
Oh, really? So you don't offer them at the shows?
I usually have a couple in my bag if somebody wants one, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But... I'd love to get some songs written specifically for me that I could do in the style of Frank Sinatra. That would be nice.
Hey, did y'all hear, you songwriters, where you at out there? You hear that? Guys looking for some songs, man. And what about performing with an orchestra? Would you welcome that situation?
Sure, I'd love to perform with an orchestra. Yeah. Probably I'd do more something like that if I went out to Vegas or something, you know, like around here. Mm-hmm. I did talk to a guy from that plays over at Heinz Hall, and I was talking to him what it would take to get a few people together, and he said it would be very expensive. So, it's hard to find the venues around here for that.
You know? Well, I tell you, I had an idea as a lot of the high school orchestras are quite capable of pulling something like that off.
Right.
You know what I mean? They always have your yearly spring concerts.
Yeah.
If I were you, I would maybe approach a couple of them and say, hey, I do a Sinatra thing. What do you think about maybe we can do something together during the spring concert?
That's not a bad idea.
You know what I mean? I mean, it's more affordable than the Pittsburgh Symphony.
Right,
you know, and it's very doable. It'd be a good experience for them as well as for yourself.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, I'd enjoy that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now let's talk about you singing another song.
Okay.
You up for it?
Sure. Let's see, what do we have?
Oh, you got?
I think I got You Under My Skin coming up next.
You Got Under My Skin. You know what? I kind of like that one.
That's
too.
That's one of my favorites.
Well, before we do this song, let me ask you, how many Sinatra songs do you personally know? Do you know?
Oh, I probably know about 80 or 100.
Wow.
And
how did you
sing about 38, 40 of them.
Yeah, when you learn a song, how do you do it? I mean, I know me myself as a musician, what I do is I put it on, and usually I'll write down the lyrics, I'll listen to the line, I'll push pause,
right.
I'll listen to the next time and push pause until I get the whole song, and then I'll just listen to it over and over and over. That's how I get it. But how do you do it?
That's what I do, too, and a lot of the CDs that I get with the song on it are karaoke CDs, so they have the lyrics, and I have a screen where they'll come up. So when I'm practicing, if it's a song that I don't know, the lyrics will come up on the screen, and I can sing it like that. Yeah. But most of the ones that I do are songs that I've been singing most of my life and knew most of the words to, whether it came to maybe the second or third verse, and I had to remember which order to put that in, and then, you know, had to practice on that a little bit. But most of the songs that I picked to do are songs that I've known pretty well.
Yeah.
You know, and every once in a while I'll come across one that's a little obscure. Like, you know, one time I was out on this guy's boat and we were just cruising around the river, and me and a couple buddies of mine, and he put in a Sinatra CD, and there were some songs on there that I never heard before.
Oh, okay.
And I said, I love that song. I got to get that.
Yeah.
So, you know, he gave me the CD or gave me a copy of the CD. And on some songs, I'm able, with the machine that I have, to dub off the vocals.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then I can put my vocals in.
Yeah.
Now, what happens, though, a lot of times with that is it doesn't dub it off completely. So when I do the song, I have to have it down pat.
Yeah, pretty, you know, close.
Yeah, pretty close, yeah. And then I can do it. But
any idea of how many songs have Mr. Sinatra recorded? Have you ever thought about that?
I don't know.
The number has to be a huge number.
I've heard in the thousands. I've heard over 1,000. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it wouldn't surprise me. I know there's some really old stuff by him where people have gotten me CDs for my birthday or something like that, you know, and I'll put them in and I'll be like, wow, these songs are old. And a lot of them I never even heard of before, you know. So I don't know what year it was where I started, actually. The album that my parents had that I fell in love with when I was probably around 4 years old was called This Is Sinatra.
Mm-hmm.
And it had songs on there like I've Got the World on a String, and Love and Marriage,
and
songs
and
like
marriage.
That. Yeah. So that's the era where I really started picking up on it and really liking him. And I mean, there's some stuff that's older than that he
did
back when he was very young that
they're
practically obsolete, the songs. I mean, even some of the words in them, I don't even know what they mean anymore. You know? So yeah. I stay away from the very, very old ones, you know, usually.
Okay, okay. Well, I forgot to tell you, man, I do a little Louis Armstrong, too, man.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, want to hear it?
Sure.
Hello, Dolly. This is Louis, Dolly. It's so nice to have you back where you belong.
Now, that would kill my voice. If I did one song like that, I wouldn't be able to sing.
I can only do that one line, yeah, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I know that one line, too, but I don't try it because that hurts my voice.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it brings me great pleasure to bring to you Mr. Guy Matone doing I've Got You Under My Skin.
I've got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me. So deep in my heart that you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin. I have tried so not to give in. I have said to myself, this affair ain't never gonna go so well. But why should I try to resist when, baby, I know so well that I've got you under my skin. I'd sacrifice anything come what might for the sake of having you near. In spite of the warning voice comes in the night, it repeats how it yells in my ear. Don't you know, you fool, you never can win. Use your mentality, wake up to reality. And each time I do, just the thought of you makes me stop before I begin. 'Cause I've got you under my skin. I would sacrifice anything come what might for the sake of having you near. In spite of the warning voice comes in the night, it repeats how it screams in my ear. 'Cause you know, you fool, you ain't got no chance to win. So why not use your mentality, wake up, step up to reality. Time I do, just the thought of you makes me stop just before I begin. Because I've got you under my skin. Yeah, you grab me under my skin. Boom, boom, boom. I get no kick from champagne. Mere alcohol, it doesn't move me at all. So tell me, why should it be true that I get a kick out of you? Some like the bar type refrain. Yeah. I'm sure that if I heard even one riff would bore me terrifically too. However, I do get a kick out of you. I get a kick every time I see you standing there before me. I get a kick, though it's clear to me that you obviously, you do not adore me. I get no kick in a plane, flying too high with some gal in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. Yet I get a kick out of you. I get a kick every time I see you standing there before me. I get a kick, though it's clear to me that you obviously do not adore me. I get no kick in a plane, flying too high with some chick in the sky is my idea of nothing to do. Yet I get a kick, yes, I get a boops, yes, I get a kick out of you.
Sitting here with Mr. Guy Matone. Hey, that last song you done for us, what was that song?
I Get a Kick Out of You.
Okay.
Yeah, it's that one and the one before that, I Got You Under My Skin, just go together so well. And I think maybe because they were off the same CD and I got used to listening to them together like that. Mm-hmm. So whenever I do my shows, I usually put those two songs together. Those were off the Reprise CD. Mm-hmm. And they were a live version, and I'm not sure where the live version came from, because not every song on that CD is a live version.
Right, I noticed that.
But I like both of those songs, so yeah. I did them both together.
You did it well.
Thank you.
When you look back on it all so far, any regrets, or if you had to do it all over again, would you do anything differently?
I don't think so. Maybe I would have started sooner, you know, okay. Would have started whenever I was a little younger. Mm-hmm. Just didn't, I guess, have the nerve to get up and do it. You know, like I say, you know, just went out to a karaoke bar one night and got up the nerve. And then once I did it, and once I got the microphone in my hand, I was comfortable with it. And I saw that people did enjoy it. And, you know, a lot of people were coming up to me and complimenting me on it. So that reinforced my feelings, because I always thought I could sing. But I never got a lot of encouragement from people, you know, just like, yeah, he's singing again, you know, whatever, because I was always singing.
Yeah.
You know, my sister would be yelling from the other room, I'd be in the bathroom, shut up in there, you know.
Yeah. Well, one thing I noticed about your performance is that versus like a band, like you don't need very much space to work, and all your music is pre-recorded, huh?
Yes, all on pre-recorded stuff, and just a very small area. I've done some rooms that were probably half the size of this studio, you know? And started doing some work at some of the senior homes around Penn Hills and around that area, and they'll just have a little living room area, you know, I go and sing for an hour, and the people just love it.
They love it, yeah, well, that's cool. Well, let's talk about some of your past venues that you performed in. Superstars in Concert.
There's a couple different shows like that around. It depends what agency they're through, but I've done a couple different ones, and some of them were for Make-A-Wish, the Make-A-Wish Foundation. And I've gone as far as West Virginia and Virginia, and did a couple of those there. And they'll usually have, you know, an Elvis, an Elton John, Dean Martin, me, you know, a few of us together, sometimes a magician, sometimes a comedian.
Okay, yeah.
And they put the show together, and I just go in and do my bit, you know, and everybody gets to see a little bit of each different performer. So it's nice. Yeah. It's nice to do that.
Okay, what about legendary superstars in concert?
Like I say, it depends what agent calls you, because I guess they have to have a different name.
Okay.
Because there is a legend show that's out, I think it's out of South Carolina and maybe a couple other places throughout the country.
Mm-hmm.
So they have to change the name around a little bit.
Okay.
Legendary stars in concert, superstars in concert. It's all pretty much the same idea, though, you know, I would say.
Yeah, so you've performed in Seven Springs?
Yes, I have performed out at Seven Springs. Yeah. I did a big thing out there last year for the Bar Association.
Okay.
So the whole place was filled with lawyers.
Is that right?
And they had sort of a casino night. It was fun, you know.
Now, I see you on here at the Cabaret Theater.
Yeah, I did a thing down there, I think it was about 2 years ago. Me and my buddy Cos, Sarah Pear, that I do the Dean Martin show with out at the Wooden Nickel.
Uh-huh.
We did a show down at the Cabaret down there.
Yeah. Okay, we got the, what is this, the King Theater at St. Barnabas?
Yeah, that's a real nice place out there. They got a nice stage and everything out there. It's probably one of the nicest senior facilities around. And I've done a couple shows out there.
So you've been doing the country club circuit too as well. I see you got the Oakmont Country Club, Edgewood Country Club, the Allegheny Country Club, South Hills Country Club, Longview Country Club, the Butler Country Club, and Churchill Country Clubs. Wow, that's pretty impressive.
Well, what a lot of those are is fundraisers for different things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they'll get one of the rooms out there, and they'll have me in to perform for the people for the fundraiser.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's always a nice venue, the country clubs.
Yeah. Okay, now here's one here, Heinz Hall.
Heinz Hall, I did a big Christmas party down there for all the employees of
Heinz
Hall.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Cool, I know that was nice.
Yeah.
What about Heinz Field? I see.
Yeah, just a couple things here and there. Like I say, probably another one of those benefit type deals, you know, or it may have been for all the employees and stuff like that. And I sang inside. Not out on like the big stage down in Heinz Field, but I sang inside in the lobby area, and you know, just people were walking around having hors d'oeuvres and drinking and having a good time.
And enjoying you.
Yes.
What about PNC Park?
Yeah, I did a thing down there, and I was actually down on the field for that one.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a little bit of fun with it because I said, you know, anytime I watch a baseball game, it seems like these guys run so slow when they're running around the bases. So after I was done with my show, I went out there with my hard black shoes on.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I just got to do it. And I ran from home base to first base as fast as I could.
Mm-hmm.
Almost broke my ankle, of course, doing it in them type of shoes, you know. But it was fun. It was kind of neat.
Yeah, that's cool, man. All right, let's see. What else we got here? We got Holiday Inns, we got Hilton Hotel, Shakespeare's, and the list goes on.
Yep, each year goes by. I could probably add so many more to the list, you know.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, you've been doing this, you said, 6 years?
I'd say it's going on about 6 years now. I mean, I kept on telling, every time somebody would ask me, I'd say, oh, about three and a half years. Well, I've been telling people that for about 2 or 3 years. I says, now I got to add the 2 or 3 years on that I was telling people that.
Right.
So I've actually been doing it for a lot longer than that. I say, you know, it's been probably 5 to 6 years now.
Well, I tell you what, man, I'm really impressed, man. You really do a good job for what
Thank you
sir.
Do,
man. It's been a real pleasure. And I'm putting my shades back on. And I'd like to let you know to keep tuning in to the Timmy Willis Show, because you never know who you're going to see on this show. I'd like to thank you once again, Mr. Guy Matone. And ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get Mr. Matone to take us on home. You want to take us home?
One more song.
He's going to do it his way. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Guy Matone.
Thanks, Tim.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few. I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more. Much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, I faced it all, and I stood tall, and did it my way. I've hauled, laughed and cried, I had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that. And may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who. Record shows I took the blows and did it my way. Yes, it was my way.
Thank you.